Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Belly Up Sound Off. Another great week ahead. We are talking All-Star Game, Home Run Derby, Justin Verlander being a baby back bitch, and a nice round table about fantasy football, top five wide receivers. I did an article on this last year, and I'm sticking pat to it, so let's rock and roll. We got the big man, Mike Brown, is back in for another week.
Oh, yeah. We're staying in.
We got my mortal enemy, KJ, over there.
What's up?
And everyone's favorite troll, ZachMac.
Punk Punk Pass in the house.
Dude,
I feel like this Punk Punk Pass troll, takeover.
I feel like we should just get Jackson a little square in the middle here.
Just like the indirect square.
Hey, real quick, before we get into anything, I do have to give a special shout out because our most loyal listener, reader, fan, and viewer of this and everything else we do is my sister-in-law, Shelby Alger. She is 100% for the BellyUp brand. So thank you very much, Shelby. I promised your sister I would do that for you.
I like it. She looks like your wife, you know, we're good with it. we're not recording yet, are we?
We are.
I'm just joking. I don't know. Let's get into this dirty.
I'm sorry. Swing for the fences.
Right back up. All right. First off, fellas, Home Run Derby happened Monday. Insanity, just so much going on. I was a little disappointed that Yelich didn't play, but I understand why he didn't. But Vladimir Guerrero Jr., man, just came and put on a show like we all hoped he would. Over 69 home runs in the first two rounds.
Nice.
Yeah. But and ended up losing to Peter freaking Alonso. That's just a Met thing to ruin the home derby.
It's hilarious. I'm going to cut you off because this is the only point I really have to make about the home run derby is how you just intro'd it. The Vladimir Guerrero Jr. show that Pete Alonso ended up winning that no one – I tweeted it out. This will always be the who won when Vladimir Guerrero Jr. hit 91 home runs as opposed to – remember when Pete Alonso won the home run derby? No one's ever going to care that specifically a Mets player, which is hilarious, that's the way it went down. It's always going to be Junior's home run derby.
Yeah. Well, here's the thing. This happened a couple years ago with Josh Hamilton and Justin Morneau. And, like, I remember because I was on the Vineyard. I stayed up till 2 o'clock in the morning when I was at Yankee Stadium. They were just blasting balls out of the park. It was amazing. But I think the issue is that Guerrero just ran out of gas. And at the end of the day, like, you can only hit so many bombs and just, like, even batting practice, what, they take maybe 50, 60 swings before a game? And they did that on top of all those missed swings, all those missed home runs. You're talking possibly 200 swings from Vladdy Jr. over there and most other guys. No wonder he ran out of gas. He's probably hacking at everything.
Yeah. I mean, so Mike, you. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Zach.
No, I was gonna pretty much just toss it over to Mike because obviously he was there. I don't really watch it for that very reason because it's not very entertaining to me. But because you get this, like you said, I mean the storylines are cool about Vlad Guerrero hitting so many home runs, but you know Alonso takes it at the end. That's just why I don't watch it. But
I mean, I honestly talking about it and listening, like this is the best thing for baseball. Like it's making my nipples hard. Like this is the only thing that's like.
Like we can sell in that photo. Yeah.
You're literally talking about, okay, so we got some seats, you know, we were up there in the nosebleed, got some good video. And I was like, you know, let's go out to the porch. There was a small crowd and we were walking down when Vlad was up and I was like, all right, I wanted to see Vlad Yelich. That was the matchup I wanted to see. And I was like, this sucks that they're matching up first round. You know, I figured they'd go later. So it kind of worked out either way, dude. Vlad's first swing was a 476-foot bomb that went through the back gates of the stadium. His second one hit, like, underneath the scoreboard and embedded into the, like, the metal out in the right field. Or, I mean, out in the left field, I'm sorry. And so we're like, dude, we got to go down there, you know? So you talk about the first two rounds, he hit 69 bombs. Literally, of the 69, 60 of them landed 5 feet from me. And I was just sitting at the bar just like, I'm trying to get video. There's no way I'm going to try to climb on these kids. So I feel like some of the video, you know, I got where people were snagging these. And then there was a few that would just Kareem on something and there would just be a pile of people. And it was just like dominoes falling over. But like you said, and you talk about, you know, Alonzo ruining it for him. But nobody even thinks about like Jock Peterson, like that triple overtime to get to where they were. Dude, literally – it was the most, like, I've gone to sporting events, you know, done different things. I've gone to playoff games. This was the most intense thing that I've ever been a part of. And literally, like, I was videoing and I had my phone up. And literally every time I would go to follow a ball, I had to immediately go back because there was another ball coming. It was just nonstop in the power. I mean, literally, I mean, Acuna even hit a few that were, you know, 470. You know, I mean, these dudes were dropping bombs. I mean, so literally, I think overall, like, I mean, in past, I mean, I feel like we always go back to Detroit because of me, but like, there's so much letdown in Detroit. I remember
the only reason we would.
When Inge was in the home run derby and he straight laid a goose egg. And I'm like, yeah, these dudes are averaging 19, 20 home runs around. And Inge couldn't even hit one. But it was unbelievable. Best thing for baseball. Even though it had nothing to do with the MLB, these dudes marketed themselves. They showcased themselves. Something that baseball can't – that they can't figure out how to do. So it was just a great experience overall. And you know, I mean, it was just awesome.
Side note, you talked about the triple overtime swing off or whatever they called it.
Yeah.
The three swing playoff in the home run derby is still better than the NHL shootout.
Oh, dude, you can take a pitch. And that's the best thing about
a lot of things is sports do better that they do better than the NHL because hockey's just hockey. But
either way, the best part about that was it kept going back to Jack. It kept going back to Vladdy. It was one swing and they tie it up and keep going. So Jack actually had a chance to tie it. He ended up lining it out on the third pitch. It was about as good as a strikeout. So it was electric. Outside of Santana going out for Cleveland, I mean, Cleveland essentially adopted Vladdy. I mean, it was unbelievable.
That's cool. It looked like a fun event to be at, especially when you're talking the MLB. There's rare an event that you actually want
and
to
be exciting. Yeah.
Man, I didn't realize there was so much baseball hate coming out of the hockey crew, man. This is ridiculous.
It's not because I like hockey. It's just like...
How many Diamondbacks made the All-Star game?
Yikes.
Two.
Was it two?
That's how irrelevant it was.
One started and actually had a double. Mike, how many Tigers actually contributed?
I can't name you.
Shane Green. He pitched the shutout inning.
Ketel Marte had the game's first extra base hit. Oh, God. Because he's the game's best...
Does Derek Jeter still play baseball?
Yeah, he ruined the
mind. Wayne Gretzky, so. Is that a thing?
Oh, here we go. Don't compare the two. Jeter's one of the most overrated MLB players ever. Wow. And Gretzky's the great one. Anyway, before we get too far off of baseball, does anyone have any last points on the home run derby? Because we've got some interesting stuff to get to with the All-Star game.
We can slide right into it either way. Like,
let's go right into the All-Star game because had I not been on Twitter, I wouldn't have even known it was happening. And I wanted to start with that. All-Star games, Pro Bowls, whatever you want to call them, normally not like great television. But the All-Star game had like 7 hits total. Like, is there anything worse than a pitching dominated All-Star game for baseball? For baseball sense, not for fans, but for baseball.
You know what's so crazy about this is that we're in a season where they're talking about, like, you know, juice balls, which we'll bring up later, and a lot of, like, home run numbers are up. But yet in the All-Star game, pitching dominated. It's, like, the strangest occurrence because generally we had, like, 10 to 15 final score games. And this was just insane.
It's like a little league game.
Yeah, but the pitching was, like, it was almost like an anomaly because usually at least it's, like, 8 to 9. I mean, last year, wasn't it, like, 3 to 2 or something like that?
Yeah, last year was a slugfest, I think.
Oh, okay. 2 years ago, it was 3-2.
But it just seems like one of the worst. Like, at least if you're going to watch the Pro Bowl, it's like 70-63. I mean, every once in a while, you get good defenses in there. But it's just like no one's trying. The problem with baseball is like you can't throw a soft pitch in there. It'll go the other way no matter what. Like, they have to play a little bit harder than other All-Star games, it feels like. But I do think it hurts kind of like baseball's marketability of the event.
I mean, still, All-Star Weekend for the MLB is probably the most entertaining.
Yeah.
It's like, because the Pro Bowl is a joke. NBA All-Star Weekend kind of lost all of it after the LaVine, Aaron Gordon dunk off. And then I didn't even know the NHL had an All-Star game until 3 years ago. That's not digging on hockey. Literally,
it's just awful. They
talk about marketing. Yeah. Don't they even do like 3-on-3 or some bullshit?
It's
like,
I mean, it's on NBC Sports Network.
That's the best part.
I don't want to talk about it.
All right. So yeah,
got
like
the chip in the hook.
All star games in sports have always been kind of like a moot point. Like nobody really cares about it. But like the MLB kind of just does it right. I mean, yeah, occasionally you have some stinkers like this, but I mean, ZachMac said before, we had a slugfest last year. We had a 18 inning game back in 2003. It's like, it's a crazy kind of event. And I mean, it still works. It's still the Midsummer Classic. It still kind of lives up to its name. It's just, this year was just solid pitching. Now their marketing is garbage and I will happily volunteer as a intern there. But you know, I don't know. What do you guys think? I just, cause like there's so many stars in this game, like guys who I've like, who would fill out a top 25 list regardless of where you ranked them. And it was very just, eh.
I think part of the problem is, and I could be wrong, but they just recently made it so the game didn't mean anything, right? Like up until a few years ago, it decided home field advantage in the World Series.
Doesn't it still? No,
they stopped 2 years ago.
Okay, oh, that's I remember so reading it, but I wasn't sure if they went through with it.
It was
that
only
seems
just
like
a
disaster.
Well, they only did that because of 2003 with the extra 18 innings and ending in a tie.
Yeah,
like,
a tie, right,
we got to make this like mean something. But now, it came to a point where like a better team would lose home field advantage and then get smoked in the World Series because, I don't know, like Trevor Story hits a dinger off of. Because
they had two players in the All Star game or whatever.
Yeah, right? It's like,
yeah, man.
Yeah, I think that's part of the problem. And it's still, and I will argue the fact like the NHL All-Star game since switching to 3-on-3 has been a little bit more entertaining. There's still that contingency of people who some are baseball fans where they can't just sit down and watch a baseball game. And because of the mechanics involved in baseball, like throwing a fastball, like trying to hit a fastball, it still just looks like your everyday baseball game to a lot of people.
Zach about that?
Well, no, we'll get into that later. Trust me. I think it's too much of a normal-ish game for like the average baseball fan to be like, oh, the All-Star game, fun, because it's a baseball game. And yeah, they can't change it because of the skill involved. It's not a knock on baseball. That's just the way baseball works.
But like, yeah, like I said, I think the best thing, not to cut you off, Zach, but the best thing for that weekend, I think that weekend of all sports is like Jared said, it's the one that people appreciate the most. More people probably go out to. But the home run derby this year was something that the MLB couldn't ever imagined. You know, like I said, they can't market their own players. Like Mike Trout is a pretty close person. You know, you don't know about him. There's not many outgoing MLB players just recently, as in yesterday, the day before, which we'll talk about. Verlander is outspoken. Again, we'll get into that. But these guys have no personality in the company, per se. You don't know anything about them outside of when they're going to different sporting events and sitting there, you know. So I think the home run derby is great. The All-Star game, a letdown, but that's – you can't coach that. You can't teach. I mean, it just is what it is, you know.
If there were no Diamondbacks in the All-Star game, would you tune in, Jared?
Yeah. Back when they were garbage in 2010, I still watched.
In 2019? No, I don't know anything about the Diamondbacks today.
They're in second place right now. I'm not complaining. I mean, the Dodgers are the best team in baseball, but they're a game out of the wild card. I'm not.
Yeah. I just wonder how many people, I mean, short of like, and this may be a few years late of a take, but like, short of like the Miguel Cabrera's, like, are Tigers fans tuning into the All-Star game to watch, I don't know, like an everyday left fielder that's just a little bit better, I guess, that made the All-Star. I don't even know how All-Star game voting works, if it's the fans
a joke. All-Star, it's a joke.
But
well, because they had to change it because the Giants fans were ruining it. They would put in like brand
new stuff. The entire team.
Yeah, the Giant San Francisco essentially ruined it for everybody for about 2 years when like Brandon Belt was beating out like guys like Cabrera, Goldschmidt, and like Adrian Gonzalez, who were all putting up MVP numbers. But Brandon Belt almost got the starting spot because the Giants fans are just rabid assholes. So it's like,
NBA had that with Zaza Pachulia or something, didn't they?
We had it with John Scott in the NHL.
Yeah, there's always like that one fan base who tries to ruin it. I mean, I just wanted Yasiel Puig rocking a sleeveless jersey in the All-Star game. Come on, like, really? That's just entertainment baseball. Like, he's the kind of guy who, like, makes the sport fun. So
from what I can gather, basically baseball has baseball fans like you, Jared, who are going to tune in no matter who's in the All-Star game. But they're not dissimilar from every other sport where it's like they are struggling to get the average, I don't want to say Joe Schmo, but the average fan, I guess, to get into any sort of All-Star Pro Bowl type event. It just, there's nothing to them that interests the average fan.
I think it's because it's so, baseball is such a regional sport that I would jump at the fact to go watch Christian Yelich and Joey Gallo and all these guys from the West Coast and Midwest that I don't get to see unless I go to see a Yankees or Mets game on TV, which unless the Diamondbacks are playing, I'm not interested. But during the All-Star game, I get to see players that I wouldn't get to see until October. So it's kind of cool in that, from that aspect. It's something that, like, a lot of other teams, like the NFL, every game is on. And the NHL, I don't really know if it's like that for the NHL because you guys have a lot of games on different networks and stuff. But the NBA, you know, it's the most talked about sport from November to February besides the NFL. So that's not really an issue. But MLB, because it's so regionalized, I learn new guys every year that make the All-Stars because I'm like, holy crap, this guy's hitting 325 with 21 dingers and like 60 ribbies, and it's June? Like, who is this guy? Like, I didn't even know Joey Gallo was until a month into his playing career. With Texas, we started blowing up. But that's because, like, it's so regional. I had to really look into who this guy was, but apparently I found he hits nothing but dingers, and it's great. So
that or strikes out. That's what I say. I was watching the lineups, and there's a few people later in the innings that they're coming up to bat. This is their first All-Star game, and they're batting 250 with 16 home runs. It's like, you know, we're kind of scrubbing the bottom of the barrel at this point.
I think also what your version of bottom of the barrel is and how bad All-Star teams used to be is a little different, because I remember some years, like, guys wouldn't even get on the field. So, I mean,
yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's when you had, like, your studs. Now it's, like, watered down. I feel like there's more consistency. Well, a lot of guys. But there, you're talking 10 years ago. What 250 hitter was making the All-Star roster?
Well, it's also the average thing you got to realize. The league, and we're going to talk about the juice balls in a second because I know we're trying to move this along here. But because KJ, I think, is going to blow his brains off if we're talking more baseball. But the thing is that
we're just going into the next baseball talk.
Yeah, exactly, right? We're just continuing the punt. This is for that time you guys talked for hockey for 30 minutes, and my brain almost imploded.
One episode.
Yes.
I hold grudges, man. It's with Pollock.
I don't forget anything.
But the thing is, with the game now is transitioning, and I guess we'll transition to the next topic. It's transitioning into a home run or strikeout game. That's why you have guys who are hitting 250 in the All-Star game. Doubles don't it's like how the NBA for a little while switched to the everything's about, say, matching three-pointers until the Bucks, Raptors, and Blazers kind of broke that mold. And even the Warriors in the finals were just getting a bucket. And it's kind of – baseball will kind of revert back to it in a little bit. But next topic is –
Hold on. Before you go to the next topic, I just got there's a tweet that came in. It said, tell John we said hi.
Oh my God.
No, I tagged Jared.
Tell Design Strat I want my shirt for free, my Alex Morgan shirt for free for that.
I responded and tagged you in it, Jared.
Dude, I love it. Yes. These dudes are
tell him John wants a free shirt for them messing my name up.
Elton John, that's the only person you can think of.
No, I said tell them, John.
Oh, I thought you said Elton John. All right, let's get into this next topic. Like,
so
Jared said,
I'll let somebody else, because I actually did not hear exactly what Verlander said. I heard it secondhand because I've been working nothing but 10-hour shifts the past 2 days. But I got the gist of it from Max Scherzer ripping him open on the air yesterday.
Scherzer did? I didn't see that.
Scherzer got after him. Scherzer called him a crybaby. It was great.
Yeah, man. Teammates. The ex-teammates, I guess I should say.
The best part is about Justin Verlander.
Dude, I thought – I just pretty much what Jared said, I was like, your strikeouts have only gone up every year since, 2000, whatever it is. And it seems like you can't be complaining about baseballs. It's like that's just – you're picking the wrong fight.
Yeah, well, he's also a fastball. His go-to pitch since he's broken the league has been his four-seam fastball going with his breaking balls. Sorry, got a little nerdy there. But fastball pitchers get lit the hell up during these games sometimes.
He's given up the most home runs this year out of any pitcher.
Oh, I know.
And he's still got 2.98 ERA.
Yeah, well, here's the thing. He's given up solo dingers because he's not getting guys on base. And so he shouldn't be complaining as much. He just hates the fact that these guys are doing these crazy bat flips on him. It's just, you know, like, to me, baseball is better when you have home runs. It's most marketed time period. I wrote a whole article about this, how the MLB should just get them over themselves about the goddamn steroid era. It made baseball fun. The home run race. Mike, you're the oldest out of all of us. You were in your like later. Ouch. I'm just being honest though. But like you were around. Sure. I was 6 years. I was 4 years old when the Maguire Sosa thing happened. You were at least around.
Dude, that's when Sosa was Sosa, not some light skin. Whatever.
Yeah, some black. Like, he's a skin disease, of course. But like, I mean, yeah, that's what it is. But like you saw Barry Bonds in 2001 dropping 71 or 73 dingers. Like that is something that like made baseball.
We'll never see again.
Yeah, exactly. And pitchers, there were still dominant pitchers in that era. And this is why I think people need to get over themselves about the juice baseballs. Chicks dig the long ball, but so do all fans. All right.
Tell me if I'm wrong. I feel like every year by the All-Star break, there's one or two guys that hit about 30 bombs. And then the second half of the season, nowhere near that pace that they keep up.
Yeah.
And, also, and I feel like
contributing factors that usually in August, you see guys drop off because of the heat. Two, pitchers usually start to figure guys out. And three, 99% of the time, those guys are in the All-Star game trying to the home run derby trying to win it.
Outswing
Yelich was smart. So, yeah. Yelich didn't play in the All-Star game. I think Yelich could get up to 60-something this year. I think he could.
Dude, to tell you the truth, I love everything about this from Verlander. I've got a soft spot for the guy.
Color me shocked.
Jesus.
I totally love it.
Please, do tell.
Ask Zach, you know, the Kate Upton gifts and stuff like that. Those are all for you. This isn't about Verlander. This goes back to the MLB. It's not so much about Verlander doing it. If Kershaw did it, I would love it. Baseball, there's nothing about baseball that makes headlines. There's nothing about baseball. Whether this was – I mean, this was Verlander just straight – yeah, maybe he was crying.
For clout.
There's nothing. I read today, the best part about this is Torrey and Leland, of all people – right before the All-Star game, pulled him into the office and pretty much chewed his ass. And he pretty much went out and said, I got my ass chewed about this. You know,
I read that too.
But the one thing about this was I don't necessarily think this was, well, maybe it was a little calculated, but there was more F-bombs that Verlander dropped in this entire quote unquote than I've ever seen a sport that any, I mean, you know, maybe outside of basketball, NFL or something like that. But like for Verlander to say this, he's obviously, you know, he's putting a lot of heat on MLB. You know, they did buy, what is it, Rawlings? Is that what the balls are or whatever? It's a $40 billion company. They bought it for $4 million or whatever. Either way, the way it was.
Baseball is the $40 billion company and they bought the $400 million company.
So either way, I think this is good for baseball. It puts a light on them. But I know there's a lot of people that really gave Verlander heat, which, like Zach said, you know, Verlander of all people, he's striking out 200 people a year, but also he's giving up the most home runs this year. So maybe this is kind of, you know, close to him thinking that. But like Jared said, dude, you're throwing 100 miles an hour. If somebody gets a hold of that, whether, you know, you're not putting a lot of people on base, so Verlander's putting a lot more pitches over the plate at 100 miles an hour because he knows that he can usually get them by you. So they're solo shots. So it's no big deal. But to me, I love it. Baseball needs this. Is it going to do anything for baseball? No. But, I mean, whatever.
I mean, would he rather the home runs be doubles and pitching from the stretch? Would he rather do that? That's how.
Yeah, have you seen his ass, dude? He probably prefers playing from the stretch.
Oh, dude, man. That was the
next I prefer him pitching from the stretch.
Him and Kate Upton's ass. That's where it was coming.
The funny thing to me is, well, one, it speaks to like the lack of drama in baseball, that this is like such a big thing, because people are always kind of like taking shots at commissioners. But I will say, and Jared, you can cover your ears for a minute if you want, but Justin Verlander's experience from what every NHL goalie has experienced over the past 10 years, it's the position that people want to see fail. Because they want the puck to go in. They want the ball to leave the air.
It's more one-on-one.
Exactly. And they want, when you're in a one-on-one position like that, whether it's a shootout or a fastball, there's one person everyone wants to succeed other than the hometown fans. But and he does it well. He's a good pitcher. But people are enjoying hitting home runs off of him and watching their favorite player hit a home run off him. It doesn't mean he's a bad pitcher, and I get his point to an extent, but he does come off as just a total crybaby about this. Like, this is, and especially imagine like football or basketball where a star complains about something, they'd get torn to shred. And he's getting killed, but not nearly as bad as if like Russell Westbrook said the ball felt heavier. It'd be like, oh, you just suck. Like, you've always been Westbrook. Like, when you're a power pitcher like Verlander, you give up home runs. Not at this rate, but he's never had, I don't want to say never, but like he's a fastball pitcher. Jerry, you said it, and you know more than I would. But this is just something that happens, and he plays a shitty position as far as personality and opinions. But he's not – baseball is not going to change the ball because of Justin Verlander. I think that's the biggest thing is, Mike, you said nothing's going to come of this. But I guess it's fun to see guys let loose a little bit, especially towards a guy like Manfred, who I guess isn't very well liked. I wouldn't know, but I don't hear good things about him.
Blood ceiling, but, you know, it's last note on this, just – fans want offense. It comes down to the NBA. You know, there's no more hand-checking. NFL pass interference is basically standard on every play now. And, you know, in hockey, they essentially want the goalie to fail. And in baseball now, you have more home runs. It's just the way that sports are going. Fans want offense. Offense sells tickets. Nobody except for purists go to games to watch defense anymore. So
people watching pitchers are also taking their own stats in the stands.
I want them to know that a juiced ball doesn't make it any less hittable or more hittable.
Well, like, it's also hitting skill as well. Guys, it's not even just a juiced ball. It's the fact that these guys realize that a home run is worth more than hitting a single and having the guy behind you strike out. So they're going to, every time they see anything that resembles a fastball, they're just going to lock their shoulders back and try to blast that thing in the next county because that's the way that they're getting paid.
I think this is perfect. I think this is the same thing. I think we need to dig up your article again, Jared, because this is the exact of players juicing. You know, the ball, whether the ball is juice or player's juice, the hitter still got to hit the ball. You know, there's still that. That's why, like, you know, like I said, I love what Verlander said, but either way, I mean, whether you're putting, you know, more rubber bands in, dude, I'm gonna tell you right now, if people want to juice, and this is kind of off topic as far as their body steroids, and I'm paying $70 to go see them, let them do it. That's what people want to see.
Barry Bonds mentally ain't too screwed up, and he took so many steroids his head inflated, but the thing is,
never failed a test.
You know, he never failed a test, all that allegedly. But the thing is, with Barry Bonds, he still had the best hand-eye coordination I've ever seen, besides maybe Vlad Guerrero.
Yeah.
Like, that dude had better eyes at the plate than any – he walked the length of the San Francisco Braves. Only about a third of those were intentional. The dude just –
You know why? The only reason why – I mean, I like Vlad, but the only reason I could not buy into Vlad, there's one reason
Senior?
I could – Yeah, Vlad Senior.
Okay.
Dude, because I was that guy – In baseball coming up, that I had to have two batting gloves. I thought I was a shit. I was the guy that had the best gear, but I was probably the worst one on the field. And Vlad comes out there with no gloves, and it drove me nuts. And he would just slash everybody.
Well, the thing is, like, I loved playing like Vlad when I was a kid because I had no plate discipline. I one time hit a double in high school. The ball bounced off the plate, and I golfed it in the center field of the kid's head.
And you tried to probably stretch it for an inside the park.
Nah, I was chubby. I knew I couldn't run.
No, but I mean, these guys are bigger, faster, stronger than they were a decade ago. Things are always going to trend this way because we're always going to find ways to build these athletes up, and they're stronger and they can see the ball better. And I don't completely buy Manfred either, saying, you know, sometimes things just happen, not as consistently as, you know, 100,000 baseballs or however many they go through. Like he said, like, it's a handmade product and things tend to change. I get it, but like, I also consume a lot of handmade products that don't. Jim Beam never changes. Smooth all the time.
I was wondering where this was going.
I'm looking at you, Jim Beam, potential sponsorship. But it is one of those things where Manfred's totally blowing smoke out of his ass, but Verlander does come off looking worse.
Oh, I love it. Right. Either way, okay.
I think we should get into this topic, because I'm like chomping the
I was just gonna say, I know, baby. Jared wants to move on, and I know the next topic may last forever. This may be our longest episode ever.
So NFC North quarterbacks.
Finally getting into that season. Finally getting into that season. Fantasy football. This week we're gonna start off with ranking our top five wide receivers, fantasy wise. I'm gonna start with Zach. And we're gonna come to KJ, and then we're gonna come down to Jared. He's got to be last.
Wait, so. Do you want us to read our whole list, or we'll like all do our fifth, fourth?
I'm gonna do my top five with like three are that are on the fringe.
Okay, that makes sense. All right.
So Zach. Are we starting five? Are we starting at five or one?
Yeah, however you want to do it. It don't matter. Yeah, five. Work your way down the suspense.
Okay.
So five. I'm gonna go with because he helped me so much on my team last year was Amari Cooper. I like him in Dallas. I think some people might have him a little lower, but I think Dak Prescott trying to figure it out is going to use Amari Cooper quite a bit. So I've got him at five.
My number five, and I hate this team, but I can't discredit what he's done. T.Y. Hilton. I just think that team's going to be really good, and I'm so anti Andrew Luck, but those two guys are so good together, and he's got a lot of weapons. And I think that's actually going to benefit T.Y. Hilton a lot. I think he's going to be a great fantasy fantasy wide receiver.
Jared, who you got at five?
Number five. See, this is crazy to me because I wanted to put Antonio Brown in the top five, but I couldn't only because I don't know what the hell is going to happen in Oakland. Now, does anybody else have this fear of mine that it's just going to – he's never going to get the ball because Derek Carr is going to get hit every other play?
Dude. They're going to be down every game. I'm going to tell you not to steal your thunder. I've got AB at five.
All right, you know what?
Because they're going to be down every game.
It was either him or AJ Green because somehow that ginger freak still gets AJ Green the ball every year. So, I guess I got to go AB five. I dropped him out of the top three, and I said this last year. It's because I could even throw Juju in as a possible top five because Big Ben's going to be wanting to talk to him. So, you know what? Honestly, I'm going to stick with Juju because – I convinced.
Wait, so now Juju's your fifth?
It's Juju's number five.
You said AB.
Oh my!
All right, chill.
It started as AJ Green.
It started.
We're getting Jared's top 10.
1,000 miles an hour. All right, but the thing is, like, I have Juju number five because of the three simple things: Antonio Brown with all the offseason crap, Big Ben. They're back. There's no distractions. He's got to prove it. And Juju Smith-Schuster has been like, "All right, I'm going to get the most targets. Let's go." And he does everything right as a receiver. Runs good routes, blocks well, catches the ball, can separate. AJ, Juju is going to be my number five.
Oh my God, it's like pulling teeth.
Okay, so let me explain what Jared's original pick was. That's my pick, is AB. Okay.
No, Jared's original pick is AJ Green.
Oh yeah, Jesus, the second pick. So either way, I've got AB at five. I talked to Tom, our NFL lead, about this. He doesn't have him in there. I've got him in there. But on that fringe, I've got the same thing, Schuster. And, you know, I was back and forth. But I think where Ben is and Carr are, I think Ben's in a worse situation as opposed to Carr. I think both teams are very comparable. Maybe the defenses are a little better. But as far as you think Connor had a year out of his ass last year. I don't think he's going to be able to replicate that. Granted, I'm not saying that Jacobs, you know, with Oakland. You know, am I saying as a rookie he's going to have another season like Connor did last year for Oakland? You know, I don't know, because that takes a lot of heat off them. But
AB also commands the ball.
They're going to throw the ball. Yeah, I was just saying, they're always going to be down. Even what made him in Pittsburgh is the quick bubble screen. So he's going to get his regardless. So, Zach, where are you at four?
Four, I had Juju, and I almost dodged Jared, but he eventually got there. So I'm going to quick switch it up with my other fringe guy, which is Mike Evans. He's the number one target in Tampa. I had him on my team last year, did very well. I keep talking about my team last year because I won. I don't know if I mentioned that, but I'm a champion. So Mike
thanks
Evans
to, rocks in. To Belly Up Fantasy.
I don't think it was Belly Up, but I don't know. Mike Evans is who I got it for. He's number one target in Tampa. I think he's who do they got quarterbacking now?
Jameis, the potato IQ.
Is it Jameis?
Potato IQ. Is it him and Fitzpatrick every week?
Yeah.
Nah, Fitzpatrick's now in Miami, so it's between him and a bag. It's between him and a bag of chips. I don't know. Like.
Either way, I think Evans gets the ball quite a bit.
My number
like Evans. So.
my number four is Juju for so many reasons that you guys kind of are all brought up with other picks. He's going to be good. He's going to be open. They're going to want to get on the ball, and I think the Steelers are going to be good. So I just kind of think it's a no brainer. At least
you
in
think
your
the
top
Steelers
five.
Are going to be good.
I do. I don't think the Browns are going to be as good as people think. So the Steelers will probably go 5-1, 4-2 in the division anyway.
There's still a lot of question marks around Juju for fantasy for me.
Oh, dude, he's not sure. Past 2 years. Anyways,
Zach, no one takes our football opinion seriously. Just like we're just here for the content. But
I can't wait to.
I'm here because I needed a fourth person. That's why.
All right, number four. I have his Instagram tag is the best line of all time. It's Can't Guard Mike. Mike Thomas. Now, dude cannot be. Dude will still catch 10 balls a game from Drew Brees. Even if Brees is he only had one. I think he had only one or two games last year. Because I had him on two of my teams. He only caught less than eight balls, like twice. And two of those games were at the end of the season when Brees' arm started falling off. I still think the Saints are going to have a rough end of the season because we saw last year at the age of Brees is not Brady. You're going to have the drop off, but that's post fantasy playoffs. So right now, I think Mike Thomas, he's a big body receiver, one of the best route runners in the league. And he just puts up numbers and he's the number one weapon in that Saints offense besides Kamara. So it's a no brainer to me. I do like the Mike Evans pick, Zach, but the one thing is it's his quarterback. If he had Andrew Luck as his quarterback, I'd put him at one. But the problem is Jameis has the IQ of a potato and he stares him down every game. He's going to get double covered now that DeSean Jackson's gone. So I wouldn't put him in the top five if I were you, but that's just my opinion.
I was between Michael Thomas and Davante Adams, and I at four I took Davante Adams.
He's my
back
six.
And forth on this. I had him obviously for me actually Evans is on the outside and so is Schuster. Not to spoil the rest of my top five here, but I've got them on my outside. So I've got Antonio at five, Davante at four. Granted, last year I think he. A lot of his points came off of touchdowns. He had big games there. I mean, there was a few games with yardage and stuff like that, but I got Davante at four. So, I mean, that's, I was gonna spin it the other way, but we'll go up to Zach now at three.
Yeah. So, at three, I have Julio Jones. And it was two and three were tough for me between Julio Jones and Michael Thomas, but I put Michael Thomas above because I think, like Jared said, his route running. And that's exactly what an aging Breeze needs is somebody who can run their routes precisely. So I think he's going to be looking that way quite a bit. And that's the reason I have got him above Julio Jones. But it's not a knock on Julio Jones. I still think he's going to get his.
And didn't he go like 12 games without a touchdown last year? Or am I exaggerating? Was it like eight?
Yeah, he started the season.
And I don't think that
he had 100-yard games.
Five different running backs.
Yeah, I don't think he'll repeat that. I think he's going to have quite a few more touchdowns this year. I like that pick at three. We're on three, right?
Yeah.
I have Michael Thomas at three. I'll just repeat what you guys said. He's really good route runner. He's a big dude. He's a Buckeye who beat Miami in the 2001 national championship. So,
aren't you a Michigan State fan, you loser?
No, that's
It was one of the greatest pass interference calls of all time. So, for all those reasons,
mean the most flawed.
For all those reasons, I'll take Michael Thomas at three.
Jesus, KJ just wants me to slug him when we meet him and meet me in person. All right, number three, I got Julio Jones as well, only because my number two, one and two guys just are numbers machines when they're healthy. I got Julio because of the route. I was a victim of his little drought last year. I ended up trading for Derrick Henry, Leonard Fournette, and everything else on this guy's bench. And honestly, I went from 0-4 to almost making the playoffs out of this. So it almost worked. It almost paid off for me. If Leonard Fournette didn't have to sit half the year. But anyway, I love Julio Jones. He's the biggest freak of nature when he's healthy. I also don't think that the Falcons are going to be as crappy as they were last year. because the Panthers, I think, are going to score points, but they can't play defense. And you have the Saints who are going to fall off a little bit because they're going to be so emotionally overwhelmed by the fact that we got robbed. So
we're going to have to think about that so much.
That's going to be it's going to be the gift that keeps on giving when they lose games. But I think Julio Jones, the problem is that he doesn't finish games in the red. He doesn't finish in the red zone. It's like the Falcons are allergic to getting the ball down.
Well, I mean, Matt Ryan's not that good either. So
I would put him in my top 15.
Yeah. I mean,
he's not in your top 15.
He might be 15.
That playoff game against the Eagles Stafford that they blew
top five.
2 years ago. I mean, he had what, four chances to get to Julio?
Don't talk, Zach. Don't talk.
What?
Not you, KJ. I'm just cutting Jared off.
All right, Mike, you're number three.
All right, I'm with Michael Thomas. Like you said, the dude is going to get his regardless. I talked about this last episode. There's going to come a time where Drew Brees' arm, like the vein in his arm, every game just looks like it's just going to shred. So
why keep starting his vein, you weirdo?
I'm all about the main vein, so whatever. But either way, Michael Thomas, I love what he does. Even when he's not scoring touchdowns, like you said, he's getting 9-10 receptions a game. He's averaging 100 yards. So,
I got him. Yards, no touchdowns.
So all right. But I'm gonna switch it up here. Now I'll do it to since you guys are a little off of
where. Well, just do your number two then. Do your number two.
That's what I'm saying. I'm gonna we'll flip it back now to Jared next. So my number two, you guys already took. A lot of you guys already did. I got Julio at two. Dude, Matt Ryan's a top 15 quarterback. I'll tell you that right now. There ain't no way that he's not. Honestly, last year I think I took him in my league. I ended up getting him in like the ninth round. I was a dumbass and I ended up taking taking God, I'm all out of whack now. Texans.
Deshaun.
Yes. Geez, why am I Deshaun? Yeah, I ended up taking him early and ended up getting Matt Ryan late. And I ended up riding Matt Ryan. So that's where I was at. Julio, like you said, my concern, red zone, touchdowns, I don't think he duplicates what he did last year as far as not getting in the end zone. They got a decent receiving core. They're consistent across the board. Carolina's fallen off. The Saints, I think their defense last year, I talked about it last episode, their defense sucks, but they ended up pulling something out of their ass last year.
They got lucky so many games.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. There's so much that in that division, I think Atlanta is gonna ride that home, and Julio's gonna have a big part in that.
They were the gimmick team that never pulled it off. So, all right. Number two for me, I got the best receiver in football, and that's DeAndre Hopkins. Last year, at the end of the year,
we're not at number one yet.
He's the best, like, on film. You know what I mean? I'm not a fantasy guy. I'm an on-film guy.
What am I thinking?
But I said he's the best receiver on the field. When he walks on the field, he's the best receiver, regardless of who's across. But fantasy-wise, my number one guy is going to put up numbers for a lot of different reasons. I'll explain that later. But Hopkins put up stupid numbers with Cody Kessler, the rocket ship, and a bunch of other rejects at quarterback. He's got another year with Deshaun Watson. He can just only get better. He made a catch underneath his legs last year. Guys, come on. The guy puts up – he's the number one target. Will Foley be back healthy, which is going to take a lot of coverage off of him, and it's just going to make Hopkins even more dominant.
Speaking of Brock, how many millions has that guy made?
He's the Bob of football.
He'll never be as good a comment as Sam Bradford.
Sam Bradford got like a robbery amount from the Cardinals and played one game.
So here's my number two is why people hate me. We'll put it lightly.
That's one reason why, bro.
It's Keenan Allen. Philip Rivers is going to have – Philip Rivers is going to continue his tear on the NFL. He'll be the best quarterback again like he is year after year. He's going to bring all his kids to the stadium every week. And he's going to feed Keenan Allen all year. Little dinks and dunks, but he's going to average – or not average a touchdown a game, but he's going to go off the charts. Like so slept on. so slept on. I won't draft him, but I think he's gonna have a great year.
He just lost all his credibility on that pick.
No, I'm a big Chargers guy. I love that pick.
Oh, he's a receiver in fantasy, but I won't draft
him. I only take Baltimore Ravens wide receivers in fantasy football.
And that's why you'll probably lose.
God, do we beat you in our league?
I love my Ravens fantasy football. Zach, who's your number two?
Thomas, who is my number two, if he's available, I'm picking him before. Assuming Hopkins is gone, I'm picking Thomas if he's available over Julio Jones. And you guys have already spilled your guts about Michael Thomas, so I'm not going to beat a dead horse.
All right, I'm taking number one. We're going to keep this going. Zach already said it. He's a freak of nature. When he's on the field, he's the best wide receiver there is, which means he's the number one, the best fantasy wide receiver. He put up numbers with every Joe Schmo in the league this year.
Throwing the ball.
And like you said, Fuller, the only thing that does concern me is Fuller has a great relationship with Watson. And when Fuller was in, I mean, he was off the charts, but.
Because they're double teaming Hopkins still.
But there's no way we'll have this conversation in a year or a few months. It's Hopkins. There's no doubt about it. So I'm interested. I mean, keeping track of Jared's because his are so outlandish. So we'll see what his number
one is. Because I'm smarter than all three you put together.
Oh, my God. Did you play fantasy with us last year? No, you didn't have enough money.
No, I didn't. I was in four other leagues already. I couldn't manage.
No, your mom wouldn't give you enough money.
Ouch. Dude. Would you stop writing because I live with my parents? I should try to save money so I'm not paying a mortgage until I'm 85 years old.
You're going to do it whether you're save 25 you're 50? Or 45.
Who's your number one?
My number one receiver is the head of all headlines this offseason. It's Odell Beckham Jr.
Oh, my
God. I knew you were going to say
it.
Because I almost called it. Baker Mayfield will throw this guy 20 balls a game. And realize if he stays healthy, he doesn't have a guy who's a special patient unit throwing the ball anymore. He's got Baker Mayfield, one of the unofficial mascots of BellyUp. The guy loves chucking the deep ball. It's a dream for Odell. The guy can turn a slant round to a touchdown in the snap. It makes more sense than ever because now he's got yes, Baker's going to spread the ball to Njoku and Landry and Callaway, but at the end of the day, the media and the coaching staff and Odell himself are going to be telling Baker, get me the ball. Because Odell's going to want to prove he wasn't a shot. It was only Eli was the reason he struggled in New York at the end. It wasn't him. So you best believe I think Odell's going to lead the league in receiving touchdowns this year.
I was making my list and I
circled. Were you checking it twice?
And I said, Jared's going to have him way too high.
Ouch. Okay, so I do think he's going to have a good season, but I'm letting my Baker Mayfield bias get in the way because I just can't put him in my top five because I don't think they're going to be very good. Jeez. I mean, relax.
Yeah, because you're a Raven.
They're still the Browns. Like, let's not get carried away. I picked DeAndre Hopkins at one. I mean, no other reason. He's just – he catches everything. Hopefully Deshaun Watson continues to get better, and they're going to be good. Zachary.
Yeah, I mean, I had DeAndre Hopkins. I mean, he's the best wide receiver, I think. He's got to stay healthy, though, obviously. So that could screw a lot of fantasy. I mean, there's always one or two that does a year. So you got to be careful of that. But it's not enough reason to not draft him first.
Yeah.
Listen, I would take Hopkins first because it's a risky thing for me. But, like, it's more consistency because I never take a wide receiver first round unless it's like there's no good running backs for like 10 picks. But the reason I picked Beckham because I think the Browns are not only going to be a freaking circus, it's because Beckham finally got the perfect quarterback for him. So that's the reason I took that. I mean, I could see Hopkins going one, but some of y'all top five were just, come on, Keenan freaking Allen, KJ, really?
I'm praying for it.
Any ways for me to make fun of your lack of football knowledge? It's hilarious.
That's a lacerated kidney waiting to happen.
Just wait. He stays healthy, though. I mean, Jared's allowed to qualify all his picks with if they stay healthy. Keenan Allen is the only if he stays healthy.
Infirmary.
Oh, so is that OBJ?
No, he's just proposing this kicking nets on the sideline.
All right, I think that wraps go ahead.
Say, yeah, we've made it through everything. I don't know where
we have a round table. Last final thoughts or whatever.
That's what I'm saying. We'll start it. So where are we going? Am I going up or am I going over here?
I don't have any burning takes.
Look different.
I don't. I was just gonna say
the bad thing is I'm doing this. And then when we edit it, I'm going to be on the opposite angle. So wherever we're at.
I've had something burning
like this
deep into my soul. I'm not even close to where you're pointing.
When you
I hate University of Michigan, for what it's worth. I think.
Oh, Shay.
I think a few of us can at least agree on that. Shay Patterson getting caught with a burner account is just pure ecstasy for me. Knowing that one of the most confident, arrogant, cocky, whatever you want to describe them as, that kid at that school in this time, especially under the Jim Harbaugh era, all they've done is talk and they don't need to defend themselves because they do their talking on the field. I mean, they can't beat in-state rivals or their biggest rival or go to a meaningful bowl game or anything like that. But they're always confident. They never really have to get into the nitty gritty of it. And then this asshole gets caught on a burner account, just basically declaring that he's going to be the reason that Michigan is successful. They're not going to be successful.
That was the funniest part.
It's so perfect for me as a Michigan hater.
I don't know if anybody's, I mean, I don't know how you can confirm something like that. He's adamantly denies it, says whoever made it didn't put the one in the right spot, but it looked pretty legit to me. So
I believe it 100%, especially a kid from the University of Michigan. That was my round two. That's all I
bring any harder table. Right now.
What'd you say?
Show your bias any harder right now.
It's the way it's college football. It's totally different.
You just said Michigan. It ain't saying anything about who he roots for.
Oh, well, I know he is because he tries to take shots at me in the chat. I'm like, hey, what was the last national championship that Michigan State had?
God. Are you even old enough to remember Miami's last national championship?
I watched it, and I was like 5-6 years old, but yeah.
I remember crying because I saw McGahee's knee just totally explode against Ohio State. I thought he'd never play again.
Yeah. All right. I got one. Ladies and gentlemen, of course, we talked about this. We didn't really talk about this show, of course, but the U.S. Women's National Team, of course, won the World Cup on Sunday. So proud of our ladies. So much craziness around the team, from sports to political to equal pay. Can we just talk about the second that these ladies whooped probably the best collection of teams that they could have played and barely even broke a sweat doing it? That's dominance, fellas. And like today, what is their captain's name with the purple hair? I cannot remember.
Megan Rapinoe.
First of all, she's crazy, but she's funny as hell. She brought up today when they were talking in New York City about, you know, equality and everyone being together and unity and everything else. It was a great speech, and I really appreciated it. I even I didn't give a crap about the Women's World Cup the last 2 years. The last two times it went through, I remember Japan, and I think the U.S. won it last time. But this year, something about it just kind of brought a lot of us in there. Because U.S. men's soccer, of course, is a joke right now anyway, except for Christian Pulisic. The thing is, like, you know, of course, then they have my crush, me and Kevin. Of course, y'all listen to our show. We shot our shots at our crushes on that team. Mallory Pugh, what up? But, you know, even if it's just Alex Morgan twerking after she wins on Barstool's page. And, of course, we have our Alex Morgan shirt, which I ordered. Check it out, BellyUpSports.com. Design treat, and Mike, and everyone.
Drop Barstool.
Listen, you know what? They're a competitor, but we got to acknowledge that they were the first one to get it on.
No, but as director of merchandiser, thank you for plugging that shirt. I bought one. Thank you.
Great shirt.
Thank you. Everyone should go buy one. It is a perfect shirt.
Oh, I am so about this, and also has Alex Morgan,
as Zach bought that shirt.
Female athlete by a country.
No problem with the shirt.
ZachMac's just a troll, dude. We should have figured.
Everyone throws me in like.
Can we get him and Jackson on the same show together?
No, I'm not doing that again.
Dude, that'd be hilarious. But anyway, just, you know what? Can we just talk about how, like, it was a great. I'm done hearing about all the U.S. flag this and Trump versus Megan Rapinoe that. I don't care. I lean middle. I don't care if you lean right, left, whatever. I don't give a crap. Let's enjoy this for what it is. Our country just whooped every other country's ass. And it was our women who did it too. So that's even cooler. And yeah, proud of the ladies. We're about to get a three-peat next time too. And yeah.
I think you brought up a good point, Jared. But it's tough to separate, and I won't get into anything political, yeah. But there's that extra sense of patriotism with this women's soccer team, because we knew the more we paid attention, and even if you've never watched soccer before, and if you hate soccer, you're turning on this game, you're supporting these women. It lets them play soccer for a living. It lets them do all these things that all these other teams and men's teams, especially in our country, get to do. And I thought that was really cool that a lot of people came together and supported a team that needs it right now. And they're incredible. They're some of the best athletes we've ever seen.
So I totally agree. I think kind of that's where my stance was, is I was kind of all over the place as far as my last round table here. Thinking about the home run derby, Peter Alonso cashed in a $1 million prize for that. And these women wow. sat there and represented our entire country and what was their purse for this. They I know it wasn't about million. The money.
Yeah.
Long term, you know, it is about the money, because I think the men were getting like 20 or I don't even know. It was something ridiculous. But
they don't qualify for the World Cup, so we wouldn't know.
Yeah. So either way, I do agree. This is something that we should definitely embrace. It is easy to find a niche and say, oh, let's take this picture, put it on a shirt because it's going to sell. That is one thing, but there's also a lot of pride in that. That's something that outside of, you know, the Olympics and stuff like that, that we don't have. Name the last dominant American team, maybe except for the Dream Team basketball, you know, like, I mean, there's been a few here and there, but I mean,
In
soccer, it's a more competitive worldwide sport. I get what you're saying though, Mike. Like, this is the sport where other countries are supposed to beat us.
That's what I'm saying. Done. Like everyone talks about, America is adapting the MLS. Like, we've had all these failed tries at soccer. You know, in other countries, they don't have American football. They don't have, you know, other sports. They have soccer. That's their number one goal. I mean, goal per se. But you come to the United States and it's watered down. So the actual, you know, television or the national audience is watered down as well. So I understand, and I've heard a lot of different hot takes about these women, where, you know, you want to be consistent, you win. Well, the women win, the guys don't win, but the guys get more of the money. So I understand, not to go on about this, but I definitely agree with Jared. Overall, it was great to live during this time frame where, like Jared says, you know, not to get political, you don't want to talk about the good, the bad, the right. There's so much wrong with the world right now, especially with the United States. Why can't we just sit back and embrace this? You know, so that's my final thing. Yeah. But
to take your thing a step further, on my podcast, I said, pay the women more. Make the men
winning. Why not?
Make the men freaking earn it. They haven't. The best team I ever saw men's soccer was the team that got their ass whooped by Ghana in the second round of 16.
I'll end it with this, but I don't have a daughter myself, but I know that everyone who has a daughter out there should be thanking this women's national team and everyone else they inspire moving forward. That's the type of squad and the type of communal effort that allows for more opportunity for girls growing up. So
I will say, Kevin and John, both, if you guys check out our website, recent articles, both posted very good articles about this. John especially pretty much touched on that, saying that, you know, little
girls. Yeah, he's got two daughters, too. and he loves the team.
So this is perfect. But not to take away from that, like I always do, I like to end it. I definitely want to thank everybody, not to switch gears real quick, but I definitely want to shout out a person that we haven't shouted out is Carter. Carter does our editing, producing, and stuff like that. Does everything. I send him over the clips. He does it, you know, within a day. I appreciate everything so much, Carter. Thank you for that.
Carter said I could be yelling at a home run.
Yeah, is this the douchebag that picked Zach in the home run derby?
That's what I was just gonna say. That was the one thing I said I would beat these dudes blindfolded. So
he knows his shit.
Carter, I appreciate everything. Thank you so much for what you do.
Carter.
Also, like I said to those Design Tree guys that listen and that put in the hours printing shirts.
Stop calling me John.
No, dude, I love every bit of that. Keep doing it. Drew and your guys' crew, we appreciate everything you guys do.
And their shirts actually show up.
I know. Yeah, I know we're a pain in the ass to work with. I got a lot of changes. KJ will be heavily involved with that. I'm excited because KJ says he's going to go check out the facility and stuff like that you guys invited him out to. We really appreciate all that going forward. Statement Games, everybody we work with, I appreciate it. But to Puck Pass, these guys here, they're above me. Tomorrow when it's edited, who knows? Corner Booth over here. Yeah, either way. We appreciate everything. BellyUp Sports, check out the website. Obviously, if you're subscribed to us, you know us. We appreciate you guys following us consistently.
Tell your friends.
Yes, we're not the only show that'll be recording this week. We've got a few more things that we'll be dropping on YouTube. So again, to ZachMac, to KJ, Jared. We're all good. No. Yeah, John. That's what I was gonna say, John. So I appreciate everything. Thank you guys. Tune in next week. Ha ha ha.